today we've got the opportunity to go and check out the garage that actually builds the cars for the Fast and the Furious series and a bunch of other movies. And while we're here, we're getting to speak to Dennis McCarthy, the guy that's in control of choosing what cars are going in the videos and essentially like masterminds the builds of these cars. So we'll have a quick look around the garage and then shortly we'll go talk to him and then ask him about some of the cars that feature in the movie. And I can spy over there, there's the Ice Charger. And we're going to speak to him specifically about that vehicle. It's one of the coolest ones here. They made, I think, 7 of them for the movie. So this one here is one of the stunt ones. It has exploding bullet things that come out of the hood and stuff. So we'll have a quick look at that. After we've had a look at some of these cars that you can notice from the original 1, 2, 3 movies. And all right, let's get to it. So what is like done to this power-wise and drivetrain-wise and everything like that?
So this is basically a 500 horsepower crate motor hooked to a turbo 400 transmission going through a company named General Dry Shed that builds all of our drive lines to a Mosier 9-inch center section, Curry housing, 35 spline axles, Detroit locker, Atlas transfer case, Sparco seat, automated race pack dash. You know, if you come to under the hood of the car, this is our what's called our bullet car. So you have all the explosive that are wired in to be deployed at the command of special effects.
And you've pushed the engine all the way back to weight distribution.
We basically, it wasn't even so much for weight distribution. We had to push the motor all the way back
to give drive.
Us clearance for the front differential. So gotcha. You can see we barely have it. It's all.
So is that another 9-inch or something?
This is exactly true. There's another 9-inch front center section. This is a Curry housing. A company called LSK built the designed the front subframe. The front seat axles were kind of a group effort. The outer spindles are basically a 3/4-ton Chevy truck. And the steering rack is a Howe, one of their fastest ratio steering racks. Brake system is Wilwood. And like I said, you can see it's all packaged very tight. Oh, the Fox fully adjustable coilover shocks, which like I said, out there in the ice, it was, you know, anything but flat, so it was a lot of suspension tuning and everything else to make it, you know, handle the way we wanted it to and stay on the ground as it should.
So the tires that are on this at the moment aren't the ones that were on there out in the ice?
They're the exact same tires, we just, these ones just don't have the studs.
Okay. So this is a tube frame chassis, is there anything original from the actual donor car? Like
just that very top section of firewall is original, the roof's original, that cowl plate is original, the panel between the back window and the deck lid is original, and that's it. You know, everything else you can see from the front clip forward, everything is our own front fenders, our own chassis. You know, the car basically is set up right now with no front sway bar. We put a huge rear sway bar in the car just to give it the oversteer you know, characteristics that we want to see in a movie. And like I say, which is pretty rare to have no front bar in it, but it was just like I said, we took the car out and that's how I like to be. So
yeah.
So yeah, overall, it's just like I said, this thing's used, it's abused. It's like I said, it's been across the ocean from New York to Iceland twice. So you can see that it's kind of taken its toll on the on its good looks, but you know, it still works, still runs, still does everything it could do mechanically that it did. You know,
so they're not really even pushed that hard. The engine could take a hell of a lot more, I suppose. It's kind of
They push it all the way, man. They are. I mean, if they didn't have a rev limiter, they'd all explode for sure.
Yeah.
No, when you're out there, man, they are literally, you know, through the gears, on the rev limiter, every shift. It's bah, 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 which is cool because it gives you that flame effect constantly because they're always on the rev limiter.
Yeah.
But no, man, they hammer them beyond all belief.
I mean, like the engine probably is, it could probably take a lot more.
It's hard to kill the motor. Yeah. It's just, you know, the way these motors are set up, you know, there's a lot of fail safes with fuel mixture, with it running lean, obviously with the rev limiter, which is, you know, a key ingredient to keeping the thing alive. We have oil pressure safeties. We have coolant. Overheating safeties that'll, you know, instantly alert the driver.
Yeah.
We eliminated the, you know, you could basically set this thing up where it would shut the car down, but what happens is you can never shut a car down at the wrong moment. So We eliminate the shutdown feature of low oil pressure or, you know, high temperature, but we retain the flashing strobe LED light right in his face to, hey, something's wrong. So it does make it fairly hard to hurt. The transmissions are built by a good friend of mine, John Kilgore. These transmissions are the same transmissions he would build for a, you know, for a Baja trophy truck. The Atlas transfer case is something you would see like in a King of the Hammers, you know, Ultra 4 Rock Race Jeep. You know, the 9-inch rear end is something that would be commonly found in a NASCAR. Axles are 35 spline, which is huge for a, you know, standard, you know, for a standard vehicle. All the control arms are custom fabricated. The front subframe is grafted into a full tube chassis that goes all the way to the back car, so the car is solid from the very front to the very back bumper. Because, like I said, obviously they take a lot of abuse, they run into a lot of things, and kind of just part of the Fast and Furious deal.
Nice. So this was probably one of your favorite ones to build for this?
Yeah, it was. Yeah, these things were just, it was just neat to build. The, you know, I mean, obviously everybody loves the Ken Block, the video, you know, and I mean, it's kind of, obviously this car kind of took on that look, not so much intentionally, but just really by necessity, just as, like I said, to package everything under there, you have to widen the track width.
Yeah.
But it definitely has that same type of a feel. And like I said, I've used that Ken Block video numerous times with his Mustang just as a pitch, you know, in a meeting. We need to do this, you know. Yeah. So I definitely owe him some thanks for that. And, you know, like I said, this car is, I think it's just gritty, mean, angry, you know, it just kind of fits. Kind of fits where Dom's coming from in the third act of the film.
Does it have any mufflers at all? Because it's not even as loud as I was expecting. For it looks straight.
It really doesn't. I mean, it's kind of a double wall pipe in the, you know, tip there on the end, so it does somewhat muffle. But no, it's really not muffled at all. We've also used heat wrap all the way under the car up through the back, which does help quiet the car down, and you know, keeps anything from catching on fire.
Nice.
Dennis, man, I really hate to see you wrecking all these Chargers. It's like, you know, so I say, well, I'm really wrecking things that nobody else in their right mind would want. You know, and if you come back under this car here, you know, you can see what we're dealing with. I mean, we literally build stuff out of garbage that we've dragged out of someone's backyard that'll have a tree growing through it, you know. And like I said, what I do, like, this is a car that was specifically designated to crash. You know, it had a cable pulling it that, you know, dragged it right in the shot, boom, impact. So, you know, if it's a solid car that has, you know, no rust, you know, two floor pans, it's a keeper. It's something that we build on the cars that we know we're going to keep alive. Like I said, there's always those few exceptions that, you know, kind of break everybody's heart. But, you know, in this case, it's a car that was destined to be destroyed.
So you said you ended up wrecking one of the Escorts. Was that an accident or...? Was that something that just had to be done as part of the script?
No, it was just one of those things where it just didn't go quite right. You know, it was a big jump sequence and it just, you know, didn't land exactly as intended. But, you know, like I said, that's kind of part of the deal in these movies. You know, you basically, you want to push it as hard as you can. You want to go as far as you can. You know, obviously safety is always the main concern, but, you know, whether the car crashes or doesn't crash, the guy's going to be all right.
Yeah.
But it just kind of overshot just a little bit and ended up killing the car. But as always, you know, we have three more lined up right behind that one ready to go, so.
All the wheel spacers. That's a wheel pressure from hell. Holy
right,
shit.
So this would obviously give you a seriously bad turning arc and horrible geometry. So
yeah.
This is kind of a car that was designed to only go in a straight line. So it basically, I think all the racket you heard was a gigantic hook being cut off the front of this thing. So this car basically was just rigged, steering was locked, and it just gets pulled into, you know, into its doom, basically.
Yeah. When you're building these cars and you have to build so many of them, what are the first things that go that you don't have time for?
Well, like I showed you on that ice charge, would be like the cosmetic under the hood. I mean, that car actually looked really great when we completed it, yeah. But after going across, you know, the Atlantic Ocean twice, it doesn't have that look anymore. So painting, I mean, we might try to rattle can it if we can before it gets loaded, but I mean, unfortunately, we just don't have the time to really prep things for, you know, longevity in the cosmetic sense. So, I mean, even the paint jobs are sometimes pretty quick and dirty. You know, I mean, we'll spray a car out. So we'll do all sorts of stuff just to make it happen. You know, then when they come back, if we have more time or if it's going to be, you know, at a press event, then we'll, you know, bring that up a couple notches. But it's, you know, like I said, the biggest challenge of my job is really time. It's just trying to get everything done.
Start using dips at all just for cost savings time, or do you find paint?
I'm sorry, what was that?
The spray on dips, have you started using those at all?
We have, yeah, we do.
I mean, cheaper maybe.
Yeah, there's a lot of things we do. There's a lot of, you know, a lot of things we'll do, like give you an example for repair, because we'll have a sheet of adhesive vinyl that we'll spray paint the same color as a car. So when they crash a car, we can basically fill the car with Bondo, smooth it out, and then lay the vinyl, you know, over the damaged area.
Yeah.
And, you know, once again, you know, you watch the movie, you can't tell. It looks great, you know, but I mean, if you saw the car in person, you'd be going,
ah. They'd touch it up in post anyway, I suppose.
If they have to, they will, but I mean, we can get pretty darn close to, you know, an acceptable, you know, look without ever busting out the paint, so.
I had a question, actually, that I came across on.
All right, so what is, like, done to this power-wise and drivetrain-wise and everything like that?
So this is basically a 500 horsepower crate motor hooked to a turbo 400 transmission, going through a company named General Drive Shed that builds all of our drive lines, to a Mosher 9-inch center section, Curry housing, 35 spline axles, Detroit locker, Atlas transfer case, Sparco seat, Autometer race pack dash. You know, if you come to under the hood of the car, this is our what's called our bulletin card. So we have all the explosive that are wired in to be deployed at you know, the command of special effects.
And you've pushed the engine all the way back to weight distribution?
It wasn't even so much for weight distribution. We had to push the motor all the way back to give
drive.
Us clearance for the front differential. So
gotcha.
You can see we barely have it. It's all.
So is that another 9-inch or something?
This is exactly true. There's another 9-inch front center section. This is a Curry housing. A company called LSK built the design of the front subframe. The front CV axles were kind of a group effort. The outer spindles are basically a 3/4-ton Chevy truck, and the steering rack is a Howe, one of their fastest ratio steering racks. Brake system is Wilwood, and like I said, you can see it's all packaged very tight. Oh, the Fox fully adjustable coilover shocks, which, like I said, out there in the ice, it was, you know, anything but flat, so it was a lot of suspension tuning and everything else to make it, you know, handle the way we want it to and stay on the ground as it should.
So the tires that are on this at the moment aren't the ones that were on there, I don't know.
They're the exact same tires. We just, these ones just don't have the studs.
Okay. So this is a tube frame chassis. Is there anything original from the actual donor car? Like
just that very top section of firewall is original. The roof's original.
Yeah.
That cowl plate is original. The panel between the back window and the deck lid is original. And that's it. You know, everything else you can see from the front clip forward, everything is our own front fenders, our own chassis. You know, the car basically is set up right now with no front sway bar. We put a huge rear sway bar in the car just to give it the oversteer, you know, characteristics that we want to see in a movie. And like I say, which is pretty rare to have no front bar in it, but it was just, like I said, we took the car out and that's how I like to be. So,
yeah.
So yeah, overall, it's just, like I said, this thing's used, it's abused. It's, like I said, it's been across the, ocean from New York to Iceland twice, so you can see that it's kind of taken its toll on the on its good looks. But you know, it still works, still runs, still does everything it could do mechanically that it did. You know,
so they're not really even pushed that hard. The engine could take a hell of a lot more, I suppose. It's kind of
they push it all the way, man. They are. I mean, if they didn't have a rev limiter, they'd all explode for sure.
Yeah.
No, when you're out there, man, they are literally,
you know, through the gears, on the rev limiter, yeah. every shift. It's which is cool because it gives you that flame effect constantly because they're always on the rev limiter.
Yeah.
But no, man, they hammer them beyond all belief.
I mean, the engine probably is, it could probably take a little
It's hard to kill the motor. Yeah. It's just, you know, the way these motors are set up, you know, there's a lot of fail safes with fuel mixture, with it running lean, obviously with the rev limiter, which is, you know, key ingredient to keeping the thing alive. We have oil pressure safeties. We have coolant overheating safeties that'll, you know, instantly alert the driver.
Yeah.
We eliminated the, you know, you could basically set this thing up where it would shut the car down. But what happens is you can never shut a car down at the wrong moment. So we eliminate the shutdown feature of low oil pressure or, you know, high temperature, but we retain the flashing strobe LED light right in his face to, hey, something's wrong. So it does make it fairly hard to hurt. The transmissions are built by a good friend of mine, John Kilgore. These transmissions are the same transmissions he would build for a, you know, for a Baja trophy truck. The Atlas transfer case is something you would see like in a King of the Hammers, you know, Ultra 4 Rock Race Jeep. You know, the 9-inch rear end is something that would be commonly found in a NASCAR. Axles are 35 spline, which is huge for a, you know, standard, you know, for a standard vehicle. All the control arms are custom fabricated. The front subframe is grafted into a full tube chassis that goes all the way to the back car. So the car is solid from the very front to the very back bumper. Because like I said, obviously they take a lot of abuse. They run into a lot of things and kind of just part of the Fast and Furious deal.
Nice. So this was probably one of your favorite ones to build for this?
Yeah, it was. Yeah, these things were just, it was just neat to build. The, you know, I mean, obviously everybody loves the Ken Block, the video, you know, and I mean, it's kind of, obviously this car kind of took on that look, not so much intentionally, but just really by necessity, just as like I said, to package everything under there, you have to widen the track width.
Yeah.
But it definitely has that same type of a feel. And like I said, I've used that Ken Block video numerous times with his Mustang just as a pitch, you know, in a meeting. We need to do this, you know. Yeah. So I definitely owe him some thanks for that. And, you know, like I said, this car is, I think it's just gritty, mean, angry. You know, it just kind of fits where Dom's coming from in the third act of the film.
Does it have any mufflers at all? Because it's not even as loud as I was expecting. For, it looks straight
pipe. It really doesn't. I mean, it's kind of a double wall pipe in the, you know, tip there on the end, so it does somewhat muffle, but no, it's really not muffled at all. We've also used heat wrap all the way under the car up through the back, which does help quiet the car down and, you know, keeps anything from catching on fire.
Nice. There's one question I want to ask. I know you, it's before your time because you didn't do one and two.
Correct.
But what's your theory on why the floor pan blew out on Brian's car while he's drag racing?
I've never figured that out.
Or the shifting.
I've yet to figure that one out. Yeah. So, like I said, if I would have been on the move at that time, I could have easily explained it. But I thought about it in my head. How can I possibly explain the floorboard dropping out? I haven't come up with that answer yet. I'm going to have to.
And do you ever sort of watch the movies have a chuckle when they go for 15 or 16 years?
Well, the way you have to look at that is every time the camera cuts the other car, he's downshifting. And then they cut back and he's upshifting again. That's how you explain it.
Okay. And the length of the runway, that's the other one people keep asking me about.
That was a very special runway, and it was designed for interstellar prototype jet that was actually never used, so that's why the runway was that long. They just have to luck out that they were actually on that runway.
Gotcha.
It is. Yep.
Got the
the Chevelle, too. With the Yanko Camaro back there.
BRZ was a logical choice for New York for, you know, in and out of the streets and drifting and everything else they were doing. So there, both practical cars, both cool, both do what they need to do. Yeah, this is another one of my favorites. This was a really cool part of the whole project was this car. And it really, I felt what was neat about it is it kind of brought back some hands-on interacting with Dom in a car, you know, because we seem to have, you know, gotten away from that a little bit through the franchise. And this was a chance to bring that back where, you know, basically Dom is in Cuba. He's put in the situation where he has to race the fastest guy on the island, and he's given really a car that's just at a complete huge disadvantage. You know, basically the slowest street racer on the island. This is another one of my favorites. This was a really cool part of the whole project was this car. It really, I felt what was neat about it is it kind of brought back some hands-on interacting with Dom in a car, you know, because we seem to have, you know, gotten away from that a little bit through the franchise, and this was a chance to bring that back where, you know, basically Dom is in Cuba, he's put in the situation where he has to race the fastest guy on the island, and he's given really a car that's just at a complete huge disadvantage, you know, basically the slowest street racer on the island. You know, luckily the car did have a turbo. Story-wise, the turbo kit is something that they, you know, got out of a salvage yard off of a marine, off of a boat situation. You know, the motor is, you know, we're assuming the motor is like a 327 from the 60s. And the fact that it was a turbo just allowed him to do his tricks with the wastegate and, you know, up the boost.
Did that make some real thing for you? It's actually doing stuff to the car, like pulling the wastegate?
Yeah.
That's all legit, yeah. Okay. So basically,
wastegate's pressure.
The theory, and I just saw the movie, and it goes by so quick that you might miss it, but I'll do the quick explanation of it. So basically, you have the vacuum line that feeds the wastegate. So what Dom does initially is he's looking for an Allen wrench. He wants to adjust the boost on the car. He can't come up with that. He just takes the top of his Coke can, pulls the vacuum line. He basically pinches the line, restricting the vacuum of the wastegate, increasing the boost maybe, you know, 5-10 pounds. So gets him in the ballpark. He does just for that, you know, just in case, he runs a piece of baling wire from the vacuum line inside the car. So if all else fails, he can yank that piece of baling wire and basically put the car into full boost, which with the size of the turbocharger would be around 30 pounds. So it's not going to last long at 30 pounds of boost, but it's going to make a whole bunch of power for a very short time. As Letty states in the movie, you know, you're basically creating a time bomb. But, you know, Dom says, yeah, well, it only has to last, you know, from here to there. So, you know, of course, in the end, it all works out. Another interesting feature of this car was in the dialogue, and like I said, I just saw the movie the first time and everyone was, you know, clapping and applauding, so I can't swear that it was in there, but the transmission is basically out of a tractor. If you've ever seen like an old backhoe transmission, which basically in Cuba is what they do. They'll take a transmission out of a tractor, they'll take a, you know, an alternator off of a generator, they'll do whatever they can do to get something back together. So basically the car is equipped with, you know, four forward gears and four reverse gears. So one lever is to shift gears, and the other lever is from forward mode to reverse mode. So
it's realistic that you can go that fast in reverse.
It's realistic, because, you know, it's always my job to try to explain these things. Hey, how does he go 100 miles an hour backwards? So
yeah.
I try to really stress the importance of that, because otherwise you're watching the movie and you're going, hey, wait a minute.
There is some
logic behind it, gotcha. and that was it. And
so that answers how they can go 100 miles an hour in reverse.
Right. So if you see it, it's quick. And like I said, the cut went by. So I have to watch the movie, and I'm hoping that it all got in there. But theoretically, you know, he spins the car around. He's already in third gear. He grabs, you know, fourth gear, puts it into reverse mode.
And then the car just keeps the speed up. So
that explains that. It didn't really quite explain that in the movie. So.
Yeah, well, I'm always worried about that. And granted, maybe, 99% of people don't care, but I care, and I know that you would care, but it's important. How does a car go that fast backwards? We know it would max out and redline at about 36 miles an hour. So that was the explanation behind it. But it was really a cool scene. We had a lot. I went through with the editors, just insert shots of the tachometer, the boost gauge, the temp gauge, it all kind of played into that whole scene. And, like I said, we'll have to watch it again and see if all those little tidbits made it in there, because they're, unfortunately, they're all critical. So, it really does. Yeah, you need that. So to explain this, here you go, because, I feel my job, as long as I can explain it, I've done my job. It's whether it all gets in there,
jump on the floor.
If they're answering these questions, yeah, that'd be a great idea. Fate of the Furious question hotline.
Where'd you find the car?
So these were hard to find, and there was actually 10 of these. So this is one of 10. Because the car really went through. Granted, when you see the film, it's a pretty quick scene, but you have to realize we were there for a couple of weeks, filming nothing but this car races in the streets. And there's a car that's for fire. There's actually two cars for fire. There's a car that's rigged for smoke. There's a car. Each car really has a different purpose. Pretty much all the cars had, good power, good performance. Once again, it looks old and aged, but if you really look closely, it's a, once again, we built a complete aftermarket chassis for the vehicle. Coilover suspension, has a more of a modern steering box. I almost wore the rack, but I thought the rack would be kind of too obvious. Ford 9-inch rear differential. The motor is actually a Chevy 400 horse 350 crate motor. And we've done everything we can to kind of give it that, 60s era look. So we basically converted the valve covers with adapters that converted from the center bolt to the perimeter bolt, so you get the right, vintage valve cover look. We painted the aluminum heads on the aluminum intake orange. The art department steps in and ages everything.
So the turbo is not actually functional in this particular.
No, if you notice, there's one key ingredient missing, which is the impeller.
Yeah.
The reason for that is, 400 horsepower is enough for all of our filming needs, and two, turbocharging 10 of these cars would really be a monumental feat, just for time and tuning and everything else. And it was actually our original intent to build one actual turbo vehicle, but as usual, we were literally taking these cars out of the shop. I would do one burnout up and down the street. The car would still have sticky, wet paint and aging, and we would load it on a trailer and it went to a boat to get to Cuba. So there's literally just no extra. We basically have to eliminate everything that we want to do and just concentrate on what we have to do to make it all work.
So if anything, this is adding restrictions that 400 horsepower because of...
So what we did for that is actually the air is pulled through this tube here. So the air comes up through the turbocharger,
So that's not the exhaust.
It pulls air through. No, it's all open on the bottom. It pulls air through here. It comes up through here.
Okay.
And we realized fairly quickly in Cuba that we were still restricting too much airflow. So we basically cut a hole in the back and put a little piece of mesh on the back of our hat to pull the additional air. And once we did that, it brought it right back to full power. So we felt we weren't.
Well, the trick to me, it actually looks pretty legit except for the no impeller, but I didn't notice that it was the whole thing's just an intake, basically.
It is, exactly. So so I do everything I can to make it look 100% correct, but there's always a little bit of movie magic behind the build to make it all work and get us through our, and the same thing with shooting too. It's like, we have limited time to build the cars, we have limited time to shoot the sequence, and there's no time for any mechanical failures. We just absolutely can't have it, because 15 minutes can make the difference between getting the day or not getting the day. So we build the cars with reliability and safety being the number one aspect and goal to accomplish and make it all happen. Yeah, that's, I think, other than the BRZ, that's all I really have here, man, for, like I said, 8 cars. If you guys are here, a week ago or a week from now, I have probably 25 cars here.
I mean, you got some beautiful machines up here already.
Now these are all cool. These are cars that basically, the Grand National, the GNX, and the Escort are cars that are kind of regularly displayed up at the Hollywood theme park, and they just basically shuffle them around, keep it interesting. The Camaro and the Chevelle are both owned by the producer of the franchise, Neil Moritz, two of his personal cars. This one's basically, if you pop the hood, it looks like a 427 car, but it's actually a 509 cubic inch, you know, probably 540 horsepower. But it looks all 100% authentic, and that's, you know, going through a board warmer, super T10 to a 12 volt, and car makes just a ridiculous amount of power. It's a fun one. Which movies the cars are from?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is the GNX that Dom drove in the fourth installment of the franchise. If you remember, it's when they did the fuel heist with the land train, which was really one of my, it was just a great build. I had a lot of fun with that. It gave me the opportunity to build a couple of vehicles like that were my childhood dreams, like the three axle, you know, 80 Chevy truck. We had the 67 truck with a gigantic, you know, big rig axle and the 22.5, you know, super singles in the back. So, you know, it's almost like just going back to being 12 years old and, you know, playing with toy cars, you know, yeah. so that they're real. And, you know, a lot of effort went into that too. And like I said, there's a lot of effort that I put into these cars that frequently you don't see. There was one particular thing that we did with the three axle trucks. I built one of them that actually had power supplied to all four rear tires, which was one of the coolest things ever. We did, you know, Willow Springs testing, just doing a whole series of, you know, drifting that thing and sliding in donuts. Mm-hmm. And it looked so cool. And I was just like, man, I was just, you know, talking to the director and said, Justin, please, man, you gotta get this thing, like coming from a standstill and just coming out of the, you know, the side of the shoulder, just completely sideways spinning all four tires. And we did it, but, you know, once again, you know, these movies always have to be condensed into a certain time frame. And unfortunately, a lot of times the things that don't make it are, you know, the car things, because, you know, like I said, a lot of times people think that, you know, the dialogue and the actors and might be more important. So there might be some truth to that. So this car, once again, we just talked about it. This is, you know, the Yanko that was driven in Too Fast, Too Furious. It ends up driven by Paul. This is a car that you basically see him, you know, launch from land and land in the boat, which was a pretty spectacular sequence. And, you know, once again, the thing about Fast and Furious movies is usually when you see this stuff, it seems unbelievable, but it's actually really happening. So there actually was a Camaro that was launched. It was completely filled with foam, so in case it went in the water, it would be buoyant and not sink to the bottom. So you know, there's so much that goes into those action sequences that people don't ever realize.
Was it launched or was it under power when
it was? It was under power. They actually ran. Yeah, it was a it was a cool scene. I wasn't there for that because I didn't do that movie, but you know, once again, it's spectacular to say the least. The Escort, everybody knows the Escort. This is a car that, you know, in my mind, it's like the UK version of a, you know, a 70 Challenger or a 69 Camaro. I didn't even realize how popular these cars were until we did that film and actually went to London with it. And you would roll up with a car carrier with, you know, a Dodge Daytona and, you know, a 69 Mustang, and thinking, man, people are going to freak out. But everybody would always gravitate towards this vehicle. And when we were there doing the build, we had a great cute crew that helped us out, the UK mechanics. And I tell you, man, those guys, this was like we couldn't even get near that car. You know, if like one of my guys walked up, hey, let me be up. Stay away. You know, they just, they took great pride in the build. The cars are very authentic. I mean, the engines, transmissions, everything about them, you know, the guys, a lot of the guys that worked in these cars were, you know, rally racers, past, current, and, like I said, it was definitely a UK favorite. It was a sad day. At one point, we did actually wreck one somewhat unintentionally, you know, but those things happen. And like I said, we always push the envelope, and when you're going for big air, sometimes it doesn't land just as you anticipate. But other than the one, they all survived, so pretty good finishing rate. Going down the list here, we have the Roadrunner from 7. So this is a car that Dom drives, and you know, once again, this is a car that it's always kind of a challenge with Dom, because it's like you can never go backwards. You know, it's like you keep getting bigger, and you know, and he's definitely a Mopar guy at heart. So you need to change it up a little bit. So the Roadrunner is a cool color. I had a lot of resistance on the color, but you know, it's like you can only have so many black cars in one movie. So let's change it up. So I won that battle, got the car painted in the bronze that I wanted with the black hood, because it kind of, you need that contrast with the hood, because it was kind of part of the factory look. And you know, theoretically in the movie, you know, it's a Hemi six-pack four-speed car, so it's all the cool stuff. In reality, we have a completely different powertrain underneath the hood, which is really just, once again, for the sake of reliability and interchangeability. If we have an issue with the motor, we can pull the motor out of anything and flip-flop things as needed. So it keeps it simple.
Can't have a generation-specific formula swap them in every.
Yeah, you know, we once again, that's always on my list. Hey, let's build a real Hemi Charger. We always wanted to build the black, you know, original Charger with a Hemi, and we've got it close. We've actually had it in there, and I mean, literally, we're so close. One time we're about to run the car, and then, hey, we need another car for a gag, so we get a rest. Like, oh, yeah, I pulled good stuff out. So we never quite accomplished. It's on my list. One of these days, we're going to do it. Above that is the 1970 Chevelle. This is a car that Ben drives in the gear. This is actually a factory original. 454, 4-speed, 12-volt car. This was our hero car. I really never received any of these. It was driven in the scene where, you know, Don Bruff's comes back by the house just down the street around the corner. And, you know, just it's one of those cars we basically purchased it and did nothing. And, like I said, this car's now owned by Neil Moritz. He comes in on occasion, takes it out for a spin, and, you know, like I said, at least keeps it going.
Needs to have like the best appearance. Like,
yeah, when I say hero car, that's going to be the car that you know, actually looks good from 3 feet away. You know, stunt cars, you know, by the time we're done, you know, they look good from maybe 20 feet away. You got to stand back a little bit. They look great on camera, but you know, there's a lot of abuse. You know, and they're built. You know, they'll have things in the nature of the fuel cell. You know, probably Detroit locker in the car, the slide rate handle, the slide rate metal. You know, all those kind of modifications for doing stunts, roll cages, etc. So this is a car really just was for, you know, permit itself to hop in, to drive the car. It's actually an air conditioning car, had all the, you know, comforts you need, so. No. Only Ben does. That's it. He's the only one, yeah. Ben gets the car with the air conditioning. Going down the line, so this was the Shaw Fast Attack vehicle in 7. Another one of my favorite sequences in the film. It was shot primarily up in Colorado, Pikes Peak. You know, the road, the terrain was perfect. We had all the off-road area we needed. You know, once again, if you watch that scene, it's pretty impressive what these cars are doing. I mean, they're going down some stuff that's incredibly steep. A lot of effort went into the suspension of the vehicles. This car actually shares the exact same chassis that Dom's off-road Charger had. So basically, the A-arms, you know, the howl rack, the sway away shocks could all be flip-flop moving around as needed. And that was one location that was really, really hard on vehicles. I mean, this one, like I said, they did well because they were extremely durable, but, you know, we killed, I think, 3 or 4 of the Fast Attack. Only, I mean, really one good Charger to move back out of 4 that we built. That were, you know, this is a car that I would say was a really high-effort build. You know, both of these were just pretty labor-intensive. It's basically trying to build a race car that would take, you know, a normal shop a year to create one. We had to create, you know, basically 8 of these if you add in the Chargers and the Fast Attack as, you know, one basic platform, you know, in just a matter of, well, I think this one was like 7 or 8 weeks. So a lot of pressure on the build. Luckily, I got a bunch of great guys that know what they're doing. And, you know, while we're in full force, you know, here at the shop, there'll be usually 60 people, 70 people, which gets pretty congested, you can imagine. So we have a serious parking problem. Less than 3 months, really, you know, and it's really hundreds of cars. I mean, granted, there's, you know, there's some cars that are relatively easy, like, for instance, the BRZ is one that we can do very quickly. Suspension kit, wheel starters, body kit, special effects comes in, has an amazing roll cage, multiple seats in the steering wheel, computer programmer, you know, comes down, he eliminates all the things that we don't need to know. I had basically, I think, 12 guys that were here just primarily to build ice Chargers. And,
really?
Yeah. So like I said, it just seems like no matter what, we always kind of so close.
Usually,
I try to do that. Now, it doesn't always work for you, stuff comes around based on schedule changes or car needs, but I try to start off with, you know, team repair, or the GTX, you know, that way you can the same guy build the same car over and over, which is a little more efficient. They know what they're doing. GTX built a car to set to keep that car going, and you know, same with the ice Charger. The guys that built the car know the car inside and out. They're there on set to make sure that car keeps going. Because it's pretty tough. Otherwise, you got a guy, you know, on the phone call from ice, hey, where's the fuel pump relay now? You know, so it's good to keep the right guys with the right cars. And I think that is all. Oh, sir, I'm sorry.
So, so from you, Fast and Furious, yeah. So this is a car, this is a Fast and Furious favorite. These are cars that are, they're really kind of starting the franchise. You know, when you look at the Supras, the RX-7, it's kind of where it all started. So this car is a great one. This is a car that I think it was maybe 5-6 years ago we actually did fully restore this vehicle for the theme park. It's really due now again to be gone through it once again because basically they just sit outside so everybody can enjoy them driving by on the tram. But this is actually one of the hero cars that originally came from the first movie and it was basically recycled for the second. But if you look under the hood, you can see it was the real deal. At the moment, it had a little rat infestation problem where it ate through the harness, so we have to get back on it and replace a large portion of the wiring harness and get it going again. But this car is a true runner, driver.
What sort of power is this one?
What's that?
It looks like a pretty decent sized turbo. What sort of power is it putting out?
I don't know to tell you the truth because, once again, this car was before my time in the franchise. I came in on the third one, so I actually didn't build this car. But, you know, rumor has it this car was making 500-600 horsepower. So once again, it's cool. These cars are great. I always look for opportunities to bring cars of this type back into the franchise. And
yeah, when are we going to see another street car?
You know what? I brought one back in 7. It was Paul Walker's personal car, which was just an amazing car. It's actually parked up the street here. I can probably, if my friend Sean is at his shop across the street here, I can get you guys in to check that out.
Okay.
But yeah, anytime I get an opportunity to do it, we do. You know, it's just... you just never know until you get that next script.
So. Kind of miss the original sort of the stuff, the grassroots stuff from number one.
It's cool.
And two.
Yeah, and I know it's cool and it's so important, you know. So
it's pretty much the most common thing that people sort of say is they're like, when are you going to bring back the original racing and instead
I
of
know,
the.
I know. And it's the problem with it is it feels like our crew, our heroes, have just kind of passed that point in their life. So it's like as much as I want to bring back. RX-7 back, if I. Said, hey, Ben, I got your RX-7 ready for 8. It would just look really funny. You know, just...
They're going from nuclear submarines to
DVD the RX-7 with the miniature nitrous bottles just doesn't fit them today.
You have to use different casts and sort of start over again.
Like I said, I'm always looking for the opportunity. And hopefully the next one we get some avenues where we can bring back some of the classic cars that the true, fans from the very beginning of the franchise have been waiting to see. So I'm with you on that. I'm going to do what I can. What's that? It is. I mean, you're absolutely right. The BRZ is really a modern version of the Supra. I mean, it's very similar balance, feel when you drive it. So once again, I mean, Subarus are great. I always try to include them in all these films. The Nissans, we've had 350s, 370s, GTRs, obviously galore. So, I try not to ever, leave them out completely and get as many as I possibly can. And, that's always kind of the goal is to get a car in there for everybody. You know, you got to get the European supercars. You got to get the muscle cars. The classics.
Do you get free reign on what cars go into, or do you get told we have to have a car for this genre?
It's kind of my world. I mean, obviously, I run everything by, Gary Gray. I run everything by Neil Moritz. Just make sure everyone's on the same page as I am. But for 99% of the time, they are. So it's a fun job. It's a fun group of people. It's kind of like the franchise portrays. It's a family environment. On screen and behind the screen. Everybody, so it's like I said, I think that's what really makes these movies great is what goes on behind the scenes is actually transferred to the big screen. So it's nothing more fun than doing these.
How did you get started? How did you become the car guy?
Yeah, just blind ass luck, really. And I mean, there's really no specific formula to that. Basically, I've always been into cars, building cars, had my own business, and years ago, I actually had a service account with Disney and NBC, fixing steak beds and executive cars. And I always had, some type of a hot rod project at my shop, whether it was, put in a V8 and a Jeep or whatever. We were always doing something cool. And I've always been into motorsports and everything else. So really just by word of mouth of, drivers, people coming through my shop in and out that were coming from the studio said, hey, I know some guy in their producer, he's trying to get this done on a show. Oh, great, send him down. So it kind of just trickled in. And it was never really my intent to get into this business. To tell you the truth, I really wasn't even aware this business existed. And it was really not until the film Bruce Almighty that I was the first time that I was actually on set. It was the first time they said, hey, you built some great cars, but we want you here to make sure they run. Okay, great, that makes sense. I'll come down and do that. So after that movie, that was kind of it. I just really never left. Went from that to Meet the Fockers and just so forth and so forth and so forth. And then,
eventually into Tokyo Drift, which was at the moment I thought, hey, this is the coolest job ever. I'm gonna, you know, let's forget about McCarthy Automotive. Let's go play with a bunch of fast cars. So that was really how it all transpired, which was just, once again, just kind of random. But I guess I was in the right place at the right time.
Did you put the Hulk car in Tokyo
Drift? What's that?
The Hulk car. Did you put that one in? Was that your choice to make the Hulk car?
The Mustang?
Yeah, that was the green, like the Hulk piston side of the car.
I cannot take credit for the whole car, no. So that one, I had nothing to do with that whatsoever. So that was Twinkie's van, and I guess the theory behind that was, you know, Twinkie is kind of this small guy that looks fairly harmless, but when you piss him off, you better look out because he'll go crazy. That's how the big fist came from the inside out. But I have no idea whose idea that was. So that's one car I can't take credit for.
Are you able to tell us anything that's behind your wrapped up?
These are totally top secret vehicles from a new movie that I'm not even allowed to talk about, so that's why they're undercover. Sorry, but in a few months we'll be able to talk about it. At the moment,
I can briefly call out the rest of the cars and where they're from.
So this is a DeLorean. Nothing really extraordinary about it. Just a DeLorean. This is a car that was built for the Universal Transformers ride at the theme park to be parked out in front. The next vehicle down, I'm told, is from The Mummy, but I can't say that I ever actually saw the movie and can swear to that. This is a car that was used for a visual effects gag in Fast 8. It actually was a running, driving ICE Charger, and it was painted all black, something for the visual effects needs. Past the Mummy car, there actually is an actual Back to the Future DeLorean that's unrestored. If you've ever been on the Universal Tour, you'd have to go back a few years, but there was a decrepit Back to the Future DeLorean just kind of sitting up by the tram garage next to a parking structure that you would drive by all the time, and like everyone would think, oh my God, that's so sad. So they finally came here with the basic intent to get restored. We just haven't got that project greenlit, but it's standing by, ready to go. A little bit further down, there's the 32-4 that was from American Graffiti, which is normally parked outside of the Mel's Diner up at the theme park. You know, but once again, right now, we've swapped some stuff out. We got some Fast 8 cars, or, you know, cars from Fate of the Furious there. So, you know, like I said, it's kind of a ever-changing environment up there, like I said, once again, just to kind of keep it interesting and change it up. So.
What's your daily driver? What do you drive?
My daily driver is honestly a Suburban. I got four kids and, you know, everything else, but my personal hot rod is a 68 Chevelle that's just parked right over here. I have quite a few, a big variety of cars, but this is one of my favorite hot rods is my Chevelle, so.
Yeah, my favorite.
Yeah, these are great. This is a car that was actually chosen by Gary Gray. We went through a couple different choices for Letty on the film. It started off with a 70 Chevelle, which is, you know, awesome car. It's great. Kind of fits Letty's character. Gary spotted a 71 Z28, kind of a wide body, old school Trans Am looking car at the SEMA show. He said, yeah, I really did this better. I said, you know, it's an awesome choice. Let's do it. And then he, at some point, spotted this car online, and coincidentally, the guy's a friend of mine, his name's Brian Hobart, who competes with this car in autocross racing. So anyways, this was a last minute change, and we ended up building five of them, and only a couple survived.
Do the characters and the cast have any input at all into the cars that they'd like to have in an episode or anything like
Absolutely,
that?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, they don't always win that battle, but they do have a lot of input. And, you know, Michelle Rodriguez is very, very opinionated about what she drives. Like I've said it before in a few other interviews, but she's still mad at me about putting her in a Jensen Interceptor in 6. She hated that car with a passion. And I had to explain to her. I said, look, I said, you've lost your memory. I said, you're in the UK. The last movie you drove a big block Dodge. This is an English-built car with a big block Mopar. I said, it's perfect. I can't possibly change it because this opportunity will never come up again. I said, this is the only opportunity ever to put a Jensen Interceptor into a Fast and Furious film. So she reluctantly stuck with it and drove the car around. But on a good note, she was thrilled with this choice. So she absolutely loved this car. I think it's on her list to own one of these cars, so we're going to try to make that happen for her. But yeah, it was a great car for her. It was a great car in the sequence. It stands out. And, you know, typically, what would deter me from this car would be the actual cost of buying these things. But, you know, when Gary Gray said, hey, man, this car I got to have, you know, man, that's going to be a tough one. You better ask for that one yourself. And, you know, 10 minutes later, okay, go to the vet. So it's
get the store to buy.
we bought some real beaters, you know, I mean, we bought some stuff that were, we had a couple nice ones, but most of them were, you know, missing motors and sitting in the garage.
Yeah.
Like I said, we had one that was a huge disappointment. We got it here and the car was literally rusted from the inside out. You say, well, it's a vet. What do you mean it's rusted? But there's, you'd be surprised how much metal structure there is within the fiberglass, under the fiberglass, in the A-pillars, and it looked like the car had been underwater for 10 years. So we had to do a whole, you know, kind of an inner structure to support the vehicle, but we got it back together, and that was one of the first cars that, you know, crashed that one.
Yeah.
But we always do everything we can to save the nicest ones.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're 95-98% successful. I mean, you know, to give you an example of that, before all-wheel drive Chargers, which, like I said, were our most labor-intensive build of Fate of the Furious, they all came back in one piece. So, and then even the two jump cars, I mean, obviously, you know, they come back with a lot of damage, a lot of bullet hits, but, I mean, none of them got crashed. And then the three cars we built for the purpose of destroying, I can give you an example of, you know, I'm glad you guys are here because I always say, hey, we wreck stuff that nobody else would restore. And if you guys want to come next door, I'll give you an example of that, but you won't believe how rusted out the bottom of this car is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just a quick question about the
yes.
Chargers right now. In terms of the Chargers, I can't really see how it became the Charger on, you know, the all-wheel drive build. Was there kind of any talk about showing the actual build happening?
There was never a discussion about that, but I would have loved that. That would have been that would have been great. You know, I mean, I think it just comes down to the amount of time they have on screen. And after I just saw the movie actually this weekend, and you know, the first pass of the movie I saw, you know, a few months back was three hours or something long. So, you know, when you see the movie, you know, like I said, in my mind, the car's the most important, but when you see the movie, there's really no dialogue they could leave out. You know, everything meant something. Everything was there for a reason.
It didn't feel that long.
Yeah, but they just can't have it go 3.5 hours. So, you know, they basically narrow it down to, you know, to the best of everyone's ability to get the best stuff in there. And like I said, this one is very story focused. You know, you have to, like I said, I kind of watched the movie too, think, well, what could have been left out and we could have had some more car stuff. There's really nothing there. You know, you needed every bit of dialogue there, and the stuff that you didn't need was so hilarious you would never want to cut it out. So, you know, I think this one just
Cuba was all about the cars and the racing, and then after that I went into
Cuba was about the cars, was about the racing, and you know, like I said, it's just, and it's not just the on-screen time, it would really be the filming time. You know, it would take us, granted, if you did a scene where Dom was actually building the ice charger, it might be on screen for a minute, but it would take us, you know, 2 weeks to film that. You know, I mean, it's just, there's just so much that goes into that with the prep, the set. I mean, there was no set piece in existence to film that. So, anyways, it sounds easy, but it's not. And like I said, at some point, you know, yeah, maybe we'll get a little more car tech in there, but it's, you know, it's just finding that correct balance, which, like I said, after seeing the movie, I think they nailed it. So,
the toy shop or the toy box in the film.
That was
fun filming that.
That was really fun.
I mean, it's fun, and you know, once again, it's like you know, I sit there and I see why. Don't stop.
Yeah.
We have the little leaks on IDX, that concept car, and two of our concept car. It was probably one of the coolest imports we've ever had in the franchise. You know, the car was all on the plane in Japan,
and you know, I always put it in like what the most prominent, you know, spot that I feel cannot be missed, and it wasn't missed. You catch it, but you better be looking for it because it goes by really, really quick. But no, we had all sorts of other great vehicles in there, and you know, and luckily there was a lot of time spent in there. And the helicopter was cool. We had the, you know, obviously that's where the rip saw is introduced. So yeah, there was a lot of money in vehicles there, and luckily, you know, this franchise gets so much support that it's easy to do that. You can make a few phone calls, you know, anywhere in the world and say, hey, we're doing a scene for Fast and Furious. We need some great cars, and word of mouth travels quick, and the next thing you know, we had more cars than we could fit in there. We had cars literally lined up out the warehouse and down the street, and it was really just trying to get the best cars in there. But then the problem was, if you see how they're up on the racks, you have no idea what a chore that was. You know, that was not easy. We had to do it with a forklift and a platform, and so just to switch one car was really like an hour ordeal, you know, just to clear a path and the forklift and everything out. So, you know, so once again, we got all the best stuff we can in there, and you know, like I said, I think that was a great scene. The MTI boat in the background was an awesome addition. You know, like I said,
shot
I think all
in New York.
No, that was actually shot in Atlanta.
That's right.
So as they exit, it's New York. You know, once you come out of the warehouse, then you're actually back in New York. All the action was shot in Cleveland, but you know, we did a whole unit just for all the hero shots. So it's tough in New. I mean, if you've been to New York, obviously you know it would be very, very difficult to film a car chase there. I mean. You know, I mean, it would take you 4 hours just to get the location with a car carrier. So, Fleetline is where we do all the action. All the hero driving stuff is shot right there in New York, and you know, all the interior stuff is shot in Atlanta. So,
was there a Lycan Hypersport in that scene? Or it might have been a Lambo. It just got flashed
out. I did not. No, okay. No, just seven. So,
what's the out of the cars that are in eight? What was legitimately the fastest if they were to really race?
They were the fastest. That's a question I get all the time, you know, is what's the fastest? I guess if you saw the movie and Dom actually has 5,000 horsepower, he's going to win. So.
Do you have a personal favorite? Kind of the car that you worked
on? I mean, my personal favorite was really the Ice Charger, and that's primarily because of its capabilities. I mean, I really like the look of the GTX. I mean, I thought the GTX just had this ominous, this dark stance. I mean, we put so much effort into getting that car. You know, it's like I'll be in the office and we'll come up with a suspension setup, and the guys will come out and I go, oh, God, it's got to be lower. And they all go, damn it, you got to be kidding me. Or, you know, my other thing is the car's got to be lower and the car's got to be bigger. You know, that's always the two things that I keep pushing and pushing for. So, yeah, the GTX, I think, was a cool car because it's kind of not mainstream. I think after Fate of the Furious, it will be a totally mainstream car. Mm-hmm. The value is going to double or triple on those things because
you know that you're a tastemaker. So these feel
popular.
Do you go like, well, I'm just
going to
buy a few of these.
Yeah, I got 30
Plymouth
satellites basically in my warehouse.
It's your fault that
R34 GDRs
now.
And I'll all be on
eBay. Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. It would be. I know, you're right.
Yeah, like now in Australia and America, R34 GDRs are just like $150,000 ever since Fast and the Furious. So.
Yeah, and when we did four, we were buying those cars for, well, the GTD, they were $15,000. We were buying a real one for, you know, about 38.
Yeah, 000. We used to be able to get it for 40 grand. Yeah, now you can't get any change out of like 80.
I know. It's amazing the influence that this franchise has on the car market. But the GTX was, like I said, that was one of my favorite cars, just kind of visually the stance. And I think for function, the all-wheel drive charge, just because it was something new, it was something different, something we hadn't done. And as soon as I, you know, got the script, I said, oh my God, we're on ice. And then, you know, the first thing, we're on ice. Well, is that going to be in a parking lot with, you know, how are we going to actually do that? But then it's like, no, we're actually going to ice. So it was a chore finding ice at that time of the year, so that's why we ended up all the way in Iceland, which was another huge blow to my whole build process because, you know, there was a couple of locations that were actually, you know, at least within the United States, it would have been maybe, you know, a 6-7 day journey, and then all of a sudden, oh, we're going to go to Iceland, and it's just going to take 4 weeks to get the cars there. So basically, the shooting schedule doesn't change. They just, oh, we'll just take it out of Dennis's build time. So it's just like, oh, my God. So we almost pulled it off. We really didn't. We had to put, I think, maybe 5 or 6 cars on planes and fly into Iceland, which is, you know, probably more than the car costs in itself just to get it there. But, you know, once again, in those situations, and you got to chase the ice, you got to do what you got to do to make it all happen. And you can't say, oh, sorry, you got to wait, because if you wait, the ice will melt. So, you know, it's just literally when we were in Iceland towards the end of the shooting sequence, you know, you were walking in a couple inches of water across the ice. So it was driving, walking. Yeah, well, stunt guys were driving. I was unfortunately walking.
So which ones were actually in Iceland? Which cars?
The Ripsaw, WRX, the Ice Charger, the Hobbs Ice Ram,
So the Mercy,
and,
actually,
the Rally Fighter.
So the Mercy Lager didn't actually make it.
Though. Oh, I'm sorry, and the Mercy Lager, okay. Absolutely.
Okay.
Oh, that car was a champ out there.
Really?
You'd be surprised. Like, we thought, oh my God, this is going to be ridiculous. But, you know, the car is all-wheel drive, so that was the reason that I chose.
Did you put snow tires on them, or?
We put studs on it. I had a bucket of studs somewhere, but we literally put 44,000 studs into all the various tires that we had. So it's an incredible time-consuming process. Like, oh yeah, just sets of tires, but you gotta think, you know, we have hundreds of cars, and then we have probably 5-6 sets of tires for each car. And, you know, as the ice changed, as the weather changed, we would have to change the stud pattern. You know, it was, you know, once again, it's like you watch the movie, and it's an action-packed sequence, it's amazing, but, you know, there's, you know, 7 weeks of filming, day after day after day after day after day. And the Lamborghinis, I felt really bad because they were just abused so heavily. I mean, we had a situation where the Lamborghini, I think, in the first day went in the back of the Ripsaw, you know, and we were basically, and I think at that point we were already lost.
Did you take one of each of those cars with you?
Like, we took three real Lamborghinis,
okay,
two fake Lamborghinis. So we had three actual real Lamborghinis, and, you know, at the end we basically pieced two of the real Lamborghinis, you know, created two Lamborghinis out of three. We had to fly someone over from London, had to get a clutch kit from Norway. I mean, you have no idea the stuff that went into keeping those cars going. And granted, like I say, hey, we do a lot of stuff that has standardized powertrain. We have a spare part for everything, but you can't do that with a Lamborghini. I mean, a headlight's $7,000, a clutch kit was $10,000. So it's like you just got to hope that it's going to work. You try to bring some paint, you try to bring what you can that you can make shift and make something happen. But of course, if that doesn't work, you have to find the parts. And then it's, you know, frequently it's a matter of putting someone on a plane with a carry-on bag, you know, with a clutch kit, which is actually what we did. And, you know, and then we brought a mechanic in from somewhere else. that was a Lamborghini specialist. My guys, you know, now my guys actually are Lamborghini specialists, but at that point, I didn't have one guy in my crew that had ever changed a clutch in Bertolago. So, you know, it was a learning experience, but, you know, like I said, I think we ended, by the end of that shoot, we'd gone through three clutches. So, and we had to use a manual transmission car because the, for whatever reason, the computer was impossible to get all the traction control out of the automatic version.
Have you ever had to change part of the script or something based on an incident that's happened during filming? Like if your car's been like unable to do it, to complete sort of part of the...
I can't say that I've ever had to change a script, but that has happened. Okay. I'll give you a great example of that and that I really love. And it was one, really one of my favorite moments in the franchise was on the fifth one. In the opening, when they're stealing the vehicles off of the moving train, there was a sequence where the heist truck actually hits the side of the train. It came in so hard that it actually stuck in the train and it almost took the train off the tracks. It actually did bend the tracks and shut down filming for the rest of the day. But that was not scripted. But it was like when everybody watched a playback, it was one of the coolest things ever. And then you see the truck kind of dragging with a tire going through the dirt. Yeah. And it was just like, that is awesome. You know, the footage went back to, you know, back to the production. And it was like, man, everyone loved it. And so that was one situation where we could have done it again and, you know, did it as it was originally intended, but it was so much better the way it just ended up. So, so yeah, if a situation arises and something happens and it's an improvement,
yeah.
You know, it stays.
Yeah. There's one question I wanted to ask. It's kind of, I know it was before your time because you didn't do one and two.
Correct.
But what's your theory on why the floor pan blew out on Brian's car while he's drag racing?
I've never figured that out.
Or the shifting.
I've yet to figure that one out. Yeah. So, like I said, if I would have been on the move at that time, I could have easily explained it. But I thought about it in my head. How can I possibly explain the floorboard dropping out? I haven't come up with that answer yet. I'm going to have to.
And do you ever sort of watch the movies have a chuckle when they go through 15 or 16 gears?
Well, the way you have to look at that is every time the camera cuts the other car, he's downshifting. And then they cut back and he's upshifting again. That's how you explain it.
Okay. And the length of the runway, that's the other one people keep asking me to ask. Yeah.
That was a very special runway. And it was designed for... interstellar prototype jet that was actually never used, so that's why the runway was that long. They just have to luck out that they were actually on that runway.
Gotcha.
What about the cast? What's it like working with the cast of the movies?
Oh, it's great. Yeah, they're all. I mean, like I said, it's a true family environment.
Yeah.
Like they can definitely all drive.
Who's the best driver that you know in the cast, and then who's the worst driver that you know in the cast, in real life?
I'm going to say that, you know, probably at this point, you know, Vin would have to be the best driver. Michelle would probably be right up there with him. Tyrese is probably the worst. I'm just kidding. I have no idea. I've never actually, Tyrese is one I've never seen drive. I just.
Who would you say is the biggest car nut out of all of
them? The biggest car, you know, they really all are. I mean, they've really, I think the franchise, they've been on this franchise for so long that they've all kind of become car nuts. They're all, you know, very particular. They all drive cool stuff. So, I mean, I can't really... You know, I would say that Vin probably has the biggest collection of cars out of all of them. But no, they all, I think it's inevitable and it's unavoidable that you're going to somehow get some appreciation for cars after doing, you know, this many of these.
If you're in the series this long, you're going to have to be at this point.
Right. Exactly. Yeah, so, like I said, it's one of those things that kind of goes with the character. Sorry.
It's all right.
I've got some Audi classic cars. Oh. So for Fast 9, some suggestions. So you've got like the with the bull bar there.
I love it, man. That looks like something off of a big rig truck.
Yeah, I've seen that like on the streets, and then that's a Holden Sandman. If you could put this, in a movie or put an actor in this, who would you put it in each of these cars? These like classic.
Let's see. It's gonna have to be someone that has poor taste. No, I'm just kidding. I'm gonna have to work on that. I think for these two cars, we have to introduce a new character.
Yeah.
I can't think of any existing characters that these are gonna work
Fast
for.
Fast and Furious Down Under.
I like that.
Yeah.
That has a good ring to it.
Tonight,
I
haven't been to Australia.
That has a good ring to it. I like it.
Yeah, we got some other. This is the Malu.
Hold me. Yeah, I love these cars, man. I think that's an awesome platform. I think this platform's been adapted to so many different cars too. You know, I mean,
this is basically what we drive in Australia.
Yeah, I mean, one of my favorite cars I had was I had a CTSV Cadillac, and I got the car just thought it was so cool to get a four-door car with a manual transmission. And then I was completely depressed when they discontinued the manual transmission part of it. But yeah, it's all based off that same Holden chassis that's been around forever.
Josh, the tall guy back here, riffs.
One of those, in fact, the very same.
One of these?
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. I'd love to see some photos of that, man. That sounds, for videos, even better. Yeah, great cars.
Is there an actor, a character in a universe that you always want to make a car for? It could be fictional, you know, Like, what's the dream?
I think I'm already living it, man. I don't know what I can do to top it. You know, I mean, I don't know where I can go from here. You know, like I said, they'd have to start some other kind of a series or something else new. Because right now, I mean, I think building cars for the Fast and Furious just, you know, doesn't get much better. So.
Is there talk of what's going to come up on the net? Is there like a?
I have heard nothing at all. No. You know, I mean,
it's like 3 months out.
Yeah. So I mean, exactly. I mean, it's if I'm lucky, it seems like that. You know, I'm going to get these guys to peel this off real quick. I assume they would stop after like 30 seconds, but it didn't work. Maybe it stopped.
Yeah. Maybe it went away. We'll see.
Without giving any spoilers away, what was your favorite part of this movie?
My favorite part of this movie is really not even the funny thing is that my favorite part would always be a car moment of the film, but my favorite part would have to be Statham on the airplane.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, it's just. Yeah. I was busting up. I thought that was great. Yeah. When I read it, I thought, God, that's never going to work. That's ridiculous. That's, you know, but you know, when I saw the movie, that was probably my favorite part. That was really cool. Yeah.
So in the next film, Dom's going to have a baby seat.
Yeah, I think Dom's going to grab a minivan.
Suck
them up. That's going to be a real challenge for me next time to build the family car for Dom. Yeah.
He's late for daycare.
It's going to be the four door Holden. You know, maybe we'll get one of these out there for him. So.
Hey, we've got some Aussie slang, car slang, and I want you to kind of, when we say I want you to try and guess what it means.
I'm ready.
No.
I didn't even guess slang, what that slang. Means.
All right, Stezza. That car's got a sick Stezza.
Stance.
No, stereo.
Damn it.
Hooning.
What is it?
Hooning. Let's go hooning.
Let's go hooning.
Hey, yeah. Hey.
Hooning would have to be picking up on chips.
No. Close. It just means like just driving fast, you know, moving around. That car is fully sick.
Badass.
Yes.
Yeah.
Got one.
Rue catcher.
When you're going out cow tipping.
No, it's one of these.
Oh,
it's
okay.
A rue catcher.
Bulldog. Oh, rue. Okay.
I've never heard it called that, to be honest. Right, yeah.
I wasn't even close on that one.
Chuck a Yui.
Spinning out the side of the car. Like a loogie.
Oh, no.
Okay, got you. Gotcha. All right.
Reggio. Did you get your Reggio, mate?
Playing reggae music on the radio.
No.
Reggae music on the Stezzy?
Registration. Yeah. Let's go to the server.
I always lack those. I'm always driving these cars up and down Clymore, and I get pulled over and I have the registration. Like, it's a movie car.
Servo. Let's go to the servo.
Servo's when you drive the car by remote control and you have a servo that controls the steering.
Service station.
Service station, okay. So far, I'm failing this quiz.
Yeah. Flog it. Let's
flog it. Flog it means hammer down.
Oh, good. Yeah,
that
good.
One I got.
And,
we use that one here in my shop.
Too, okay. So. Ute.
A Ute is a Mercedes military vehicle.
Oh, no, it's a.
That's a Unimog, I think.
Utility vehicle.
Utility vehicle. Okay. Yeah maybe Unimog is what I'm thinking of. Yeah. Utility, you're right. Okay. Yeah. Got it.
So that's research for Fast and Furious Down Under.
I'm going to have to get a copy of that because I'll forget all the But thank you for the education.
Yeah.
Love it.
Okay.
1 minute break for Dennis.
Yeah.
What I did is I called my buddy, who luckily is a friend of mine, said, Brian, he lives up in San Francisco. Brian, we got out of your car, so we brought his car down. We basically just applied vinyl. To his quarter panel for fenders, and we just laid glass right on top of it to make a mold.
Okay.
And literally like one day, let that cure for days, and then we just started coming apart. If we would have had more time to do this, way too hard to get functioning doors and all that stuff, and for just a shell with fixed flex stand glass, we could have done it, but once again, it was just, you know, the only way we could accomplish this deal was, you know, just go out like anybody else is and start looking for Corvettes.
Could you ever call up and say, I'm looking at Fast and Furious 9 and any XYZ cars just because you want to have a play with them?
Me, like, as far as going, who?
Like, just putting the word out saying, I'm kind of looking for these type of cars and just say,
I don't. And there's a reason I don't do that is because if you do that, the price goes up. You know, if they know that you're shopping for a car for a Fast and Furious movie, you know, you lose all your bargaining power. So
it's like driving Miss Daisy 2.
Right. We never reveal that it's even for a studio until the deal's made, handshake's done. Okay, here's the check. Oh, it's for a studio. We do that. Oh, nothing. Don't worry about it. Take off. Yeah. So,
what's the most in like real world power? What's the most power you've ever got out of one of the cars you built for a movie?
Oh, I mean, surprisingly, it really goes back to Tokyo Drift.
Uh-huh.
We had a Nissan 350, the DK car, that had a twin turbo system by a company called Brainstorm. I'm not even sure if they're still in business now, but it was, you know, 800 plus horsepower at the flywheel and put down, you know, almost 700 at the tire.
Sure.
So, and that was necessitated by that whole sequence down at Lower Grand where you had a...
So you actually legitimately needed that power to do the...
We did. Yeah. That was Tanner Faust behind the wheel of that. We had Reese Millen driving the Mitsubishi Evo. Samuel Hubinette was in the Veilside RX-7, which was really a 500-600 horsepower car. That thing was... I mean, you probably know more than anybody because you're the RX-7 expert. But that car had a massive turbo. It was wickedly fast. And, you know, there's shots of those guys, you know, literally just drifting those cars, you know, all the way through, you know, going 70, 80 miles an hour. And that was one of those times when we had to have that big power. And, you know, I mean, like I said, Reese Millen, you know, every time you got in the car, it's too slow, you know. So it was like, I remember one night we gave him, the first time we gave him the Mustang, which, you know, in the movie was, there was one truly, you know, R34 GTR powered Mustang, but all the other ones were, you know, 351s. But I think we start off one night with a 302 car that probably had 350 horsepower and, you know, 48 gears and a spool and a thing, and this isn't even close. I'm like, all right. You know, so the next night, we literally overnight, we brought back another motor that was a 351 that made probably 450, and same thing. No, it's not. We ended up with a 440 inch, you know, aluminum, I mean, just 560 horsepower motor for the guy. So, but like I said, it's those things that, you know, make the difference. You know, if it's a difference between him, you know, accomplishing what he wants to do and not, you know, you gotta supply it.
How did you start the shop?
Well, like I said, it started way back on, I actually already had a shop, so I had that, I had the real estate part covered, and it just kind of morphed into, you know, a custom auto shop / you know, repair shop into a, you know, movie car shop.
And how long ago did you start?
That had to be around like 2002, somewhere in that vicinity. So, you know, over the years, we've increased the size. You know, I mean, here we have, you know, there's three other buildings in this complex that are, you know, packed full of cars and parts and everything else. So,
and is it just movie cars that you're working on? I can see some.
Yeah, pretty much everything in here is, you know, four films from the film. I got my 17-year-old 16 Marabout that we're building. This was actually a car from Fast 7 that was never used.
Does that happen much, that you build cars that just for some reason don't get utilized?
Not usually, but it does happen. You know, there's, you know, sometimes the script changes, the character changes, or somebody just gets juggled around where, oh, okay, we don't need that anymore. So, you know, it's kind of when we start the build process, like, you can kind of sense where there might be a couple loose ends, so you try to focus initially on the things that you know that are solid that aren't going away.
Yeah.
And then, you know, hopefully you, you know, roll the dice correctly and, you know, you don't waste time or money building a car you don't need. But like I said, the Mustangs were one of those vehicles.
Do you have a ballpark of how much the actual car builds cost for the, I mean, I know that some of them,
number on the specific car build. My budget really encompasses more than just the build. My budget encompasses employee, office staff, craft service, the dumpster.
So just because the car's worth 50 grand doesn't really mean anything.
If you look at basically look at a cost report or what's spent on a car, you'd be, that is staggering. But, you know, you have to realize that there's a lot more that just went into the car than.
Any idea how many cars you've built over the years for movies? Approximately?
I don't. Thousands. I don't know. Yeah. That's a good question.
Over 100 for Fast 8?
I mean, there's probably 600 cars in Fast 8. I get that question all the time, and I should really sit down and do the math, but it's like, it's so hard because, for instance, I have a whole unit working in Cleveland that's literally going through, you know, 60, 70 cars a day. You know, they're just, and we basically just do these, like, rent to wreck, where we'll find like a wrecking yard or used car lot, and we'll just say, hey, we need all these cars, we're going to give you X amount of money, they're just to rent them, there's no time for paperwork, and we just bring them out, we wreck them, the car carriers come in the end of the night, they clear them all, they bring back the next batch the next day. So, I mean, like I said, if you saw that movie, you see all the cars that are piled up. There's no CG there, that's all real cars that are piled up.
Really?
I mean, literally, we had to recreate that set piece where, you know, where he's coming up, where he's walking over to the to the limousine. So we basically transported a huge chunk of those vehicles from Cleveland back to Atlanta. And we had to basically off of, you know, 100 photos, recreate that exact pile up of vehicles. So we had a controlled environment, you know, for the fire, the saw, could take the time and the noise and everything else. So, yeah, it's a tremendous, tremendous amount of vehicles. And then we have an ongoing list of all the cars that are actual purchased cars or build cars. But like I said, it doesn't include, for instance, all the cars at the fish warehouse. Yeah. You know, that's something that's another, you know, 60, 70 cars that are just basically rentals that are there for 4 days and then they leave. So, but like I said, I'll get back to you guys on that. It's just going to take me, you know, about 8 hours.
You know, how many movies have you been involved in, approximately?
I would say 20 maybe. I'm not sure.
That's a lot. You know.
How many cars are there?
You mentioned. I actually was seeing that you worked on Death Race.
I did.
Can you go back and maybe talk about the Mustang with that big coffin on the back of the tombstone?
How did
that work? Like, was it an actual just a huge hunk of steel, or what was that?
No, that was all basically made out of sheet metal. Yeah. Special effects department basically created that out of sheet metal. And then the art department came in and aged it. And like all the welds, you know, were actually like silicone beads. I mean, it was pretty, like you could get this close and you'd swear it was, you know, weighed 5,000 pounds. But that was a fun movie though. That was really, it was a blast. I've been involved with all the Death Race films. We've recycled a lot of the Fast and Furious cars for Death Race. Like if you watch, I think it was the very last one where they had the whole off-road event. You know, there was a lot of cars that were, for instance, like the Fast Five, like the train heist vehicle, which was very depressing because, you know, they survived, like the hero ones, like, or I'll say like my best stunt ones did survive Fast Five, but then they get destroyed in Death Race. You know, they never made, they literally came back in a box, you know, with just the key parts and the motor. Here's what came back from your heist truck. But the Gurkhas, a whole bunch of different vehicles have been, you know, reused for Death Race. Yeah, it's a cool concept. It'd be nice to see another Death Race. But go all out, you know, go big time with it because it was such a great story. You know, I mean, obviously I was a fan of the original one way back when in the 70s, so.
I think you worked on Bruce Almighty and, what kind of brief was that for each of cars?
So Bruce Almighty actually had a lot of cars, and people don't really realize that because they all got cut out. But we built the St. Lean F7 there's a long story behind that car because that was when that car was first developed, first released. The car we actually had was the first car ever built. It was Steve Stanley's personal car. So, you know, obviously with a prototype car, there's going to be some issues and this and that. So, you know, that was kind of one of my main responsibilities, just caring for that car. And we built a really cool car that I'm so depressed got cut out of the movie, but I'll tell you guys about it. As you remember, he drives a 280Z and it's silver. So in one sequence, he kind of becomes like a race car driver first. It was kind of a Mario Andretti influence sequence where the car slowly morphs into the St. Lane F7, but one of the scenes was it had to burn rubber for like 300 feet. So we put this wicked small block Chevy in the thing with a giant nitrous unit and a real high stall converter, and you know, obviously had a blast testing that, you know, that we could burn rubber for 300 feet, and then that just went away. And there was a couple other big car scenes that just kind of, you know, once again, at the end of the day, it's, you know, there's someone else that really determines, hey, what's the most critical elements of what we've shot and, you know, put it together. And Meet the Fockers was obviously just a motorhome. So I was that. It's funny, like on this movie, it's myself and, you know, 70, 80 guys. On Meet the Fockers, I was picture car quarter with myself and one helper. You know, so it's you know, kind of one extreme to the other. But I tell you what, I was.
We can turbo in the motorhome.
There you go. There you go. But being just one guy, I was off the business. So.
Yeah.
Do you ever run into any issues with manufacturers not being happy with the way that their cars are depicted or something? I mean,
it's
like,
happened, but it's probably best I don't even talk about it. But yeah.
I was just like sort of thinking, sure, like that the whole auto drive.
We have some great support from manufacturers. You know, one obviously being Dodge. Dodge has been a huge supporter of the franchise.
Yeah.
It's really just integrated into the brand, and their cars work so well. I mean, obviously the franchise would never, you know, do something with a car that didn't fit. So the car has to work for what we're filming. It has to work for the characters, and so, you know, obviously Dodge and you know, Fate of the Furious. You know, we're gonna have the new greatest. Latest and greatest Dodge, you know, it's wicked, yeah, beyond wicked. So, you know, it's cars that if we didn't have to deal with Dodge, it's a car that I would still want to have in the franchise because it fits so perfectly with, you know, everything we've ever done to date.
Yeah, that's
real good. Demons.
I'm not even allowed to talk about those yet. They're so that's a very top secret project. I can talk about it. If you guys are here tomorrow, I could tell you everything about them. But today is literally the big release of them, and so you're gonna have to wait 24 hours. Actually, you have to wait about 12 hours, and you have to call me back, and then I can.
It's that time in Australia, so it's like 7 a.m.
I got my guy. I'm gonna get like a little text when okay, demons are fair to talk about. Right now, it's still under wraps. Yeah. But no, it's great. Same with Subaru, Nissan, Mercedes, Jaguar. I mean, we really get support from probably almost every brand out there. I mean, there's really a spot for almost any kind of vehicle, in the franchise.
Yeah, the Morris Minor.
I haven't yet. That's one that we actually have not featured yet, but they are very cool. That would be a good. There's a lot of cool. I mean, the list goes on and on. I mean,
what's like the if you get like a checklist, like hey, let's get a Morris Minor in there.
Well, I mean, like an example on this one, I wanted the car that I thought was perfect for Shaw, but it was just unobtainable. Was like a Lamborghini Miura, that like the old classic. I really feel Shaw should be this connoisseur of fine European vehicles, and it's just it's like I said, it's always just this timing thing and trying to find the car and then get the car to work in the location, and and it's hard to get your hands in those cars, hard to insure those cars, hard to get the guy that owns a car to part with it. So
car that you said?
A Lamborghini Miura. It's one of
I know a guy a few miles away that has one.
What year? Like an old classic?
60 Miura.
Yeah, they're awesome. I know. It's one of my favorite body styles. ever. So yeah, there's always those cars that I want that you just can't quite pull off. But the good thing about the Fast and Furious, there's always another one coming. So if I don't get what I want in this installment, we can shoot for next time. So eventually I'll get them all in there.
any details behind the scenes stuff that you would like people to know about what you do or the cars you build?
Yeah, I think we've covered it all.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think if there's anything else we've left out. I think we've kind of touched on all the main
vehicles. Can I give you some actors' names and you recommend a car for them?
Sure.
So I'm going to give you an actor's name and you got to like match the car to them.
Okay.
Scarlett Johansson.
Right out of the top of my head comes the E06 Corvette, only because she drove a Corvette. I know in one of those films it wasn't his E06, but
Okay. Bill Murray.
Bill Murray. For some reason, I see him in the Dumb and Dumber van. I don't know why, but that's what popped in my mind on that one.
Clint Eastwood. Yeah, it's Scott Eastwood. Is that?
Clint Eastwood should definitely be driving like a 70s Lincoln.
Will Smith.
Will Smith would be driving. He's a tough one because he plays so many different characters. He can.
Will Smith's the rapper.
Yeah, but Will Smith the rapper. Okay, I'm going to just go, I'm going to have to go with a SRT8 Jeep.
Oprah.
Oprah, G6 Jet.
And last one, Trump.
Oh,
Trump.
Man.
Let's see, I'm going to put Trump in a presidential Cadillac limousine. I don't know why, that just came to mind.
They're the ones that go. If anyone else has got another action.
I think Trump needs to go bigger. He should really build like a big truck, like a 10-ton.
Yeah.
Something
yeah.
or other.
Just driving a bus.
Maybe it's a little more bulletproofing than normal or something. Something really, Oh, hey, we could put that, what'd you call it? The bumper? The roof?
Oh, yeah, the roof.
That on the front.
Yeah.
There we go.
Swedes driving through protests to get out of the White House.
There you go. That would be a perfect fit. So. Love it.
What's going on here today? What are these guys working on? He's messing around with the Charger.
Yeah, so that's a car they're going to do that car's going to London, actually.
Oh, cool.
For another Fast and Furious.
One of them somewhere.
I would just